Beautiful viewers and listeners out there, it's your favorite channel, Nebo TV. Today we are going deep into the Benin history. As we all know, Benin has had relationship with the Europeans since 1400 AD. So during their first visits, a lot of events transpired. What are those things that happened during the first visit of the Europeans? We are going to be unveiling that today. And to lead us through this unveil is none other than Master Raymond Ebengo from the Palace of the Oba of Benin. My name is Agbaje Onome. Join me as we see Master Raymond. Hello, sir. A wonderful day to you.
Good day, ma'am.
All right. So, would love you to introduce yourself formal to the viewers.
Okay. Thank you very much for the opportunity given to me to be in Nebo TV. My name is Ebengo Raymond Osarabo. I'm the Palace and Curator. It's a pleasure to have you around.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much. It's a pleasure to have you, an honor, in fact, to have you. All right, we're going to talk about the colonial masters, the Europeans, their visit to the Benin Kingdom. A lot of things transpired, a lot of things that people out there don't know happened and probably has one or two misconceptions about what happened. So we want you to really tell us what transpired, what happened during the visit of the colonial masters, the Europeans to be specific, the Portuguese, the Dutch, the Spanish, in Benin.
Okay, thank you very much. Like I said earlier, when we talk about the colonial master, for me, in my own opinion, I'll still give it for the Portuguese because they were the first person to visit Benin Kingdom during the reign of Oba Ayiwai the First in 1400 to thereabouts, because they were Oba Ayiwai the First maintained a good relationship with the European before Ozolwa, and that of the relationship becomes stronger during the reign of Oba Esige in 1504 that joined his ancestors in 1550. Permit me to say, we don't use the word death for an Oba, the journey's ancestors. During the colonial master, because what they was really interested about the Benin Kingdom is, when they were traveling through the land, the sea, it was in Benin Kingdom, they saw a house filled of mold, there was a door, there was that of a window. So they were so interested and wow, a lot of people like this have their own brain, their sense, deep sense as they all think. So that was why they were very interested in Benin Kingdom. And the uniqueness of our culture also interested them as well. Irrespective of, they see the way the Benins have respect for Oba of Benin. Because with the Benin, we believe that Oba of Benin is a God representative on earth, we beg to serve him. That's why the Portuguese was interested in Benin Kingdom. And if you look at most of the languages that we speak, also originated from Portugal. Irrespective of, when you see a Portuguese man, we see Ekuye, Upu, these are borrowed languages from Benins. We call Adane, Uko, that's what we call our knife and that of the spoon we use. But the Portuguese also introduced Olokun to us, the river goddess.
Oh, the Portuguese introduced Olokun to Benin.
The Portuguese also introduced the first church, one of the older churches in Africa, Olaya Rosa Cathedral, that was established in the year 1517 during the reign of Oba Esige. The reason why it was like that is because Oba Esige was an Oba who speak foreign language. He stopped the killing of a queen mother. Unlike before the crown prince ascended the 18th throne, they had to sacrifice mother. The reason because, as an Oba, you don't kneel down to greet anybody. Only the Oba have the right to change the Benin culture and tradition due to socialization and development. Esige was king. Why killing my mother? Letting weakness marry. He created the office of the first queen mother, Idiani Esige. A woman who also stand in behind his son to ensure that the uniqueness of his son reign in Benin Kingdom. That was how Oba Esige was also an Oba who used foreign weapon, he speak foreign languages, thereon and so on. So that was why I'll still give it to the colonial master. But because of the British, you know, I'm not using the word they are selfish or whatever. They like to make a landmark anywhere they visit. The basis of the British come aboard in the year 1578 during the era, you know, Oba Ehembuda, which was the 19th Oba among the 40th Oba.
Because so
the
president that was their first visit.
The first visit. So the first visit that they were also hearing about the Benin, the uniqueness of the culture, how the Benin respect one man, how the Benin look at our Oba, as a God representative that will still practice it today. When you see any Benin speaking person, if you are in church, if you are anywhere, when you offer prayer, you say, Oba Atok Mere. It's a way of saying, Long live the king. So that is why when the British will keep proceeding, they were wow. Why would people be respecting Oba just like they respect their own queen? But they don't know that Benin's have always looked at our Oba like Osalubua Nabum. That means God representative on earth. A representative of Oba. A representative of God himself. It's true about unlike when the Christian will pray through Jesus Christ our Lord. We the Benin believe we are praying through Oba of Benin to God himself and that of our ancestors. Are you saying it? Yeah. So we are here.
Okay. So more on the colonial masters' visits regarding the artifacts. Like you said what really attracted them to Benin? How did they come? What was their purpose and all?
Their purpose is like, you know, when a lot of people, you know how the British are the white men do their whole thing. They love to search for something, they love to search for greener pasture, they love to move. When they create something, they would like to make a test run of it and all that. When they created the ship, they keep traveling from land to land. They want to see how people, if other place people exist, like the visit to Africa. So the visit to Africa, they get to a place, they hear about the Benin Kingdom and Deriba. And I believe what was really interested them to know that a place like Benin exists. Because in 2010, there was a city called Japan. And Japan has a city called Edo City. If you look at the world map now, you see the Edo City. In 2010, they were here to pay Obare their homage that they were once conquered by the first Obarewai. Because the first Obarewai was crowned in the year 1440, he joined the ancestors of 1473. The first Obarewai fought 201 towns and villages. He made them also here to Benin. He did not only fought in Africa, he did not only fought in Nigeria, he also crossed across the sea. He fought in Asia, in that city in Japan called Edo City. And the way he was doing it, he was a great physician. The land was always disappearing and appearing when he was doing nothing. So that was why he was the person who established, who expanded the Benin Kingdom beyond reasonable doubt. That was why during his reign, that was when the Portuguese visited before we now have Elba Izotin, whose reign was the shortest over that lasted 14 days, before Ozola took over, Ozola the Conqueror, which was crowned in the year 1478, joining ancestors 1504. Oba Ozola was the father of Exige, but during the reign of Oba Ozola, the relationship between the Beninese and that of the Portuguese became strong, irrespective of slave trade and thereabouts. That was why they were also, Oba Exige was an Oba one who went to war, were using foreign weapon. He conquered towns and villages, also make themselves to Benin Kingdom, as the way of his forefather did. Why the first.
Right, talking about slave trade, how was it done back then? Now we've heard lots of stories about slaves. So did the Portuguese or the Europeans just come and started trading our people to be slaves, or how did it start?
It was not really our people. Like we said earlier, the first of all, we conquered 201 towns and villages. Most of those towns and villages that were captured, keeping them as a slave. But we also use them for our den, maybe in our farming work and all that. And you know, a lot of things, a lot of people will come to say that we heard that Benin was using Mabia sacrifice. That was back in the days. It was like that before. Are you saying it? And it was not the indigenous of the Benins. It was those towns and villages that will capture, that will make subjects to Benin, you know. They were also the one that we were using for this same trade.
For the same trade. So the Portuguese, did they take advantage of that fact and started enslaving the Benins or what?
They were never. Portuguese was also behind the Oba Benin. So maybe as we were going, I'm going to show you some pictures where the Portuguese were paying homage to Oba Isige. We have it here in the palace. Maybe that picture I'm going to explain much better.
Okay. So if there was this cordial relationship between the Benins and the Europeans, that's the Portuguese, what brought about the invasion 1897?
Okay. You know what brought about the invasion 1897? That is why, till today, in Benin Kingdom, it is only mandatory for all the first son of Anoba to be well lenient in order for them to be steadfast. In our ramification, we don't know what they're doing in terms of education. Irrespective of where the British visited Benin Kingdom, the Obavora, the Dubowa, the Obavora, son of Obadolo, was having a festival in Benin called Agwe Festival. Agwe Festival represents peace, it bring honor, it bring protection, a lot of things to the Benins. At that particular time, the Oba is not expected to see anybody. And you know the British now, when they keep coming and keep coming, they say they cannot be stopped by one man because you guys respected your king. We whatever our queen says is superior than that of Yoruba says. And we didn't know that we have a tradition. So the lot of the chiefs that were sent down, some of them were all tempered. They were all tempered. Okay, this is the place we kept to you. The British will keep proceeding and proceeding. That was how they invaded the British over there at Wotton. They killed some of the British. One or two of them were able to escape. That went for the reinforcements. Went for the reinforcement. That was how the Benin massacre came aboard in invasion in 1897. So there's also a movie that I'm going to refer to, Lasco to do the DGM. He did that. I remember when I was here in the palace, the script of that movie, spent 9 months with Obari Dewa. He reviewed it himself. He made some corrections about it. While Lasco Timans from the DGM said that when the movie is being added, it's going to be shown in the first cinema in the year August 20, 2013. So when the Brits, when they were shooting the video, when they were showing that cinema, the British had returned two artifacts that were in possession of that Philip Walker, the captain who led the British army to invade Benin Kingdom. It was his grandson, was Mark Walker, who returned the two artifacts, Iron and Egogo, to Benin Kingdom in that same year in 2013. So also attracted the whole world, the media, everything from the French and all that were interested. Wow, that if a movie like this was there to talk about the return of the stolen artifact, the British like return tool that was in possession of one man. So if you look at the new king, the Obaewa II about Benin, he will emerge the throne of his father on October 20, 2016. That will also be a day to celebrate his birthday as well. He wrote a book to mark 2 years anniversary, which I'm going to be introducing to you soon. It's called The Benin Monarchy, The Acknowledging of Benin Kingdom. When the book of that book was over 27 contributed editors, 555 pages, when a copy was sent to Queen Elizabeth II and that of the Crown Prince Charlie, they have agreed to return 40% of the stolen artifacts. Like in Benin Kingdom, in January, we are expecting a return artifact. The whole artifact that is in Germany will be returned to Benin Kingdom. So that's what is a plus mark. So we are showcasing to the world that those artifacts, they are not the rightful owner. They belong to the Benins. They were taken from this palace and it should be returned to the same palace.
Yeah, so I assure you that they are actually going to return these artifacts. And when was the proposed date of return?
In June this year, we had the German ambassadors. They were here to see the Oba of Benin, to also say that they are returning the artifacts. Then the Oba of Benin also partnered with the state governor. So a representative was sent to Jama to see. So the Jama now, a returning date for this is January, but the date is not really known, but they are returning it in January. So the monarch is trying to also erect a building that will go to be called the Palace Museum. So where people will be seeing these artifacts, we will be talking more about these artifacts. So good news to our Oba of Benin.
Wow, that's great. Oba ga tope, he said. All right, that's great. This is actually the book he was referring to, so the Benin Monarchy.
What you're going to be saying in the book is so big.
Yeah, okay, I'd love to ask, was there anything like bargain to return the artifacts? Was there anything like a bargain between the Benins and the British?
To let you know that, like we said earlier, that all the first son of Anoba was steadfast to be well learned. And if you look at this Benin monarchy, because our monarch was an ambassador to 5 different countries before he became Oba of Benin, which the last one was in Rome. So he tried to use his own experience of working with the white men for years, being ambassador, trying to use his own experience. So that's why he wrote a book. Inside the book, he was able to convince the whole world who truly owned those artifacts, trying to use inexperience, so good also the Oba. So, and what he's doing, and it's really working for him. So to let you know that we have a king that has the Benins, everybody in mind, irrespective of what rightfully belongs to the Benins, belongs to Oba Benin, is let to be returned to the rightful owner. So then the British Island, also thanks to the Germans as well. So the Germans have decided to also like, wow. So we really see the rightful owner of this artifact. Because at that particular time, they were sold. When the fashion was happening in the British, the UK, it was sold to different countries. The money they raised, what they used in surviving themselves at that particular point. So if they sold some of these artifacts to Germans, and the Germans are really saying, we made a lot of money from what we don't have. It's not even the properties of the British. So let you know that they are having a guilty conscience. It's just like when you say you found that place, or ability to convince people that this is right for them. Unlike when you meet a lady, you say you want to get married to a lady, you have to convince her. So the ability to convince and every other thing was really written in this book. And this book is recommended for everybody to have. It might be expensive. I clear ahead, it's close to 80,000, but it might be expensive. It's recommended for everybody to have to know what is really happening, to know what's in there, because the introduction in lots, it made everyone know that the Oba of Benin is really, really resilient. And he's also trying to use this as an avenue, you know, helping the state government, helping the Edo people in bringing in a lot of development to the society. And if you know, if a development is in a society, now you have opportunities and all that. Mm-hmm. So that's why if you see when the Oba emerges the throne, the rate of a human trafficking was stopped in Benin Kingdom. So that of the city of Kagera and all that was stopped. So this is a way of bringing in investment so that the youth and all that when George is doing something.
So. All right. That's awesome. It's been great so far. So you mentioned Ugoton.
Yeah.
So what was the key role Ugoton played in this whole relationship between the Benins and the Europeans? What significant role did it play as a village?
Okay. There's another question. As a palace and curator, you've also said something. If you look at Ugoton was like, Benin will say, Odeneimi Layuwa. That's what we'll call it, where the dead and that of the coming back to life, their roots.
The passage road.
And if you look at it, the first palace was built at Ugoton. So that would be, I believe we're going to be doing this some other time because they see a lot to talk about. So let's give our audience, our viewers, a few package. They will see after that because I'm also going to do some findings because I know that the present palace was not here. It was relocated to the outbeat of the nation, which is the city. Ugoton was a bit fast from the city. That's why we're relocated to this place. So to let you know that Ugoton have always been there, right from the offset of the Ogiso dynasty and that of the kingship that come in 12th century to present date. So Ugoton is a place that we also need to visit. So I can as well give you key factors and all that of where and where to visit. I will do that. I'll find this. So I believe there's also people there from Ugoton that will explain much better. But I want to let you know that Ugoton will be there right from the one, right from offset, right from the origin of Benin Kingdom. So Ugoton have always been. That is why one thing I've also observed about Ugoton is if any Oba is going to be coronated as an Oba, it started most of the activities at Ugoton. Are you seeing it? So Ugoton is also is like
why is Ugoton the center? Why was there anything?
The key factor, irrespective of, you know, when the Oba emerges a king, he mentioned the key factor of what I was going to be doing for the Benin Kingdom. He mentioned the Gidigele support. If you look at the Gidigele, also he mentioned the Ugoton. Are you seeing it? So it's like if the Gidigele support is being opened now, that the development is going to come from that Ugoton and then to the Benin Kingdom. So you see that Ugoton is going to be left out. So Ugoton is still part of the key factor.
Okay. Tell us about the Gelegele Seaport.
Gelegele Seaport, at least, what we heard about the Gelegele Seaport, the Oba main interest, no? So that of the state government is saying they need to do the roads that lead to the Gelegele Seaport. In other words, when you are bringing in the federal government for approval for there to be a seaport and all that, it will be easy. So all routes that are related to Ugoton is under processes.
Okay.
In terms of dualization and infrastructural development.
All right. Back then, during the visits of the Europeans, was it the Gelegele Seaport that they passed pass through to come to Benin?
Like the Portuguese, the British, other people that visited Benin Kingdom, they do pass through that Gele support.
What about trade back then in the when the Europeans visited Benin? How was the trade like?
What do you like when you heard of so much about the slave trade and all that? They like there was also trading on this hour. You know, Benin have known to be the best bronze caster, and that was the best carving in the world. As we are talking now, you see Benin Makayo City, you just imagine it and start carving it. Have you seen it? It's just like this, the trade was like we're also trading on these cow rings, the beads, we're making all those things. Outside the slave trade, we're making all those the beads, the cowries, and so many things we can think of. That was the British was so interested in the trade. And if you look at the old route they were all following was that of the Gilegele Silk Port as well. Because that was the only place they see and all that they was doing. And if it was all good, it was awesome for the Benin Kingdom. That's it.
All right, thank you so much, Master Raymond. Thank you on this wonderful unveil of the relationship between the Benins and the Europeans during their visits to the kingdom. On this note, we are going to end the show on the Colonial Masters right here. Thank you so much for watching. See you next time on Nebo TV. My name remains Agbaje Onome.